So this lecture will be about, let's say, the small scales of the ISM. So I will discuss the star formation on scale going from molecular clouds down to the protostar. So it will not be a proper lecture nor a review, but I would like to give you a flavor of what is done in the numerical modeling of a star formation on scales smaller than the kiloparsec, so down to AU scales. Okay, so first I would like to introduce myself. So I am a researcher based at the Centre de Recherche Astrophysique de Lyon, so in France. I am in a team based at École Normale Supérieure, and in our team we are studying the structure formation in the universe and on scales which range from cosmological scales down to planet formation and Brondarf and stellar interiors. So I am using a numerical simulation to study star formation. So I use and develop the Ramsey's code, which is developed by Romain Tessier. So in particular, I've developed some tools to integrate radiative transfer, magnetic field in Ramsey's, as well as a solver to deal with anisotropic diffusion, as for instance, the diffusion of cosmic wave. Then I apply these tools so to star formation, and both for low and high mass star formation. So today I will speak mainly about low mass star formation. I'm also interested in molecular clouds evolution, and also in comparing numerical works with observation. And for that, so we need to do some synthetic observation. So I also provide some synthetic observation from numerical models. Okay, so the outlines of my talk are the following. So first, I will introduce the context of this research, tell you what are the challenges when we want to study a star formation at small scales. Then I will speak about molecular clouds formation and evolution, and dense core formation. So I will cover scales going from kiloparsec to the parsec. Then I will focus on smaller scales, so on the collapse of dense core, and I will speak about the formation of the protostellar disk and of the protostar itself. So here we will cover scale from parsec to AU. I will then briefly speak about the cluster formation, and finally give you some perspective work on what I think the model will do in the coming years. So to begin with, so as you probably know and have already heard during this call, so the interstellar matter is subject to a cycle. So all begin in the warm ionized medium. So this is the diffuse medium with density typically of one particle per cc, relatively hot. And because of the cooling and heating processes, there can be, this medium can be subject to an instability, which is called the thermal instability. I think that François Blanger already told you about it, and we will come to that later. And with this thermal instability, what we can produce is a second phase, which is in pressure equilibrium with the WNM, so the warm neutral medium. And this phase is called the cold neutral medium. So as it is in pressure equilibrium, this phase is denser and colder than the WNM. So this is in the CNM that H2 molecule will form and where molecular clouds will form. So the molecular clouds have temperature, typical temperature of 70 Kelvin, density of 10 to the 4 particles per cc, and sizes of about 10 to 100 parsecs. So these molecular clouds, as you will see, are observed to be turbulent. And because of the supersonic turbulence, so there are some overdensity that can be created. And this overdensity can become gravitationally bound. If they exceed the gene's mass, they can also collapse onto themselves. So these entities are called dense cores. So the dense cores are really the densest part in the ISM. So they have a density of 10 to the 7 particles per cc, temperature of 10K. So you see that it's even cooler than in molecular clouds. So here it is because of the thermal emission of the dust that is thermally coupled with the gas. So the dense core are gravitationally unstable. They can collapse under their own gravity. So we enter in the protostellar collapse phase. And during protostellar collapse, we form different objects. So first, of course, the protostar, which will become the star, and also a protostellar disk, which has a size of about 100 AU. And this protostellar disk is the precursor of the protoplanetary disk in which then planet will form. So I would just like to mention also that we are currently thinking that also maybe planet formation should already begin at the protostellar disk stage. So this system will accrete matter and the star will form. And you see that the conditions in the stars are very different than the one in the molecular clouds. So you see that the density has increased by 20 orders of magnitudes. As a consequence, the length, so if you increase the density, the Jeans length will decrease as the inverse of the square root of the density. So you see that then we have to cover 10 orders of magnitude in length. Okay, the temperature also will increase by about six orders of magnitude. So here you see that if we want to study a star formation, we need to account for multi-scale physical processes. Then to close the interstellar matter cycle, so we need some process to close the loop, and these processes are called feedback. So there are various feedback processes, and all these components can interact with the other component of the interstellar cycle to, for instance, destroy the parent molecular cloud, stop the star formation, and begin another cycle of star formation. So among all the feedback processes, there are the jets and outflows, which are commonly observed in a young protostar. There are also the stellar winds, the radiation, in particular from the massive stars. So for very massive stars, the luminosity scales with the cube of the mass. So meaning that if you double the mass, you increase by one order of magnitude, roughly the luminosity. So they can provide some strong feedback on their surrounding. Then there are also cosmic rays, which can be accelerated in accretion shocks, but also in supernova remnants. So when stars evolve and explode at the supernova, cosmic rays are also accelerated. And there is also, of course, the supernova feedback that can efficiently then affect the surrounding and begin the another cycle. Okay, so today we will cover all the scales ranging from molecular clouds down to the protostars. So a second thing that is particular with the star forming ISM is that so first, when we look at the galaxy, we see something at all wavelengths, meaning that there are photons at all wavelengths. Then the gas that we observed is turbulent, and in particular in supersonic turbulence within molecular clouds. As you have probably seen in the lecture by François Boulanger, when we look at all scales in the galaxy, we see evidence of magnetic fields. So clearly we need to account for magnetic fields. There are also solid phase in the ISM, so the dust. So it's relatively tiny amount of dust in comparison to the gas, so 1% in mass. But as you will see, dust are very important. They regulate the thermal behavior of the collapsing gas, and they can also regulate the coupling between the gas and dust mixture and the magnetic fields. Finally, we also observe some high energy particles, so the cosmic ray. And the beautiful thing in the ISM is that when you look at the energies that are involved by all these components, we see that there is an equipartition of energy. So meaning that the thermal energy, gravitational energy, kinetic energy, magnetic energy, radiation energy, and cosmic ray energy are all of the order of 1 electron volt per cubic centimeter. So this clearly indicates that all these component processes should affect the star formation process, and they are coupled together. So in addition to the multi-scale processes, you see that when we want to study star formation, we also need a multi-physics tool. Okay. So clearly, we make progress in the field, but slow progress. So we try always to add more physics and also to add more resolution in the model. So before I continue, I would just to introduce you the different numerical methods that are used to study star formation, or more generally, structure formation. So there are currently three main numerical methods. So the first one are the grid-based method, where the domain is discretized in finite volumes, in that case, and we look at the evolution of some conserved quantities like the mass, the momentum, or the total energy within cell, and for that we compute the flux at cell interfaces. Okay, so most of the code using grid-based method use a Godunov scheme to compute this flux, where Riemann problems are solved at cell interfaces. So this is an Eulerian view of the hydrodynamics, and on top of this finite volume method, then we employ adaptive mesh refinement, where the grid can be adapted to the physical, let's say, condition. So here is an example of a collapsing core, where you have here the density map, and we refine the grid according to the Jean's length. So the higher the density, the smaller the Jean's length, and then the higher the resolution. And you see that, well, a lot of IMR levels can coexist in a single snapshot in order to describe well what is happening at the smaller scale in order to resolve the Jean's length. Okay. So this is an advantage of the IMR code, is that you can use very different refinement criteria and concentrate the CPU time, let's say integration time, on the region of interest. So you can use different refinement criteria, for instance, on shocks, on gradients. So it provides a very good accuracy in all the domain. There are some, of course, disadvantages, like some grid effects, so if you are not careful with the integration along the direction, and the IMR structure is relatively complex. Then there is a second method, so which is an opposite view of the hydrodynamics. So it's this time a Lagrangian view of the hydrodynamics. So the fluid is discretized on super particles that move. So these particles have a constant mass. So this is what we call smooth particles hydrodynamics. So there are various codes in the community that are used. So here is an example of SPH particle distribution, in the collapsing core from a simulation by Matthew Bate. And you see that, again, in the high density region, we have a high concentration of particles, while in the low density region, you have a low concentration of particles. So here you see directly an advantage of the SPH is that it is naturally adaptive, and you concentrate resolution in the high density region. The only thing you have to be careful about is that if you want to follow the gravitational collapse, then you have to be sure that the mass of the particle must be less than the Jean's mass. So and even more than that, the mass of the SPH kernel, so basically in order to compute hydro quantities with the SPH method, then we average the quantities over a given volume that contains about 50 neighbors, and this gives you approximately the size of the resolution element in SPH. So SPH has also some disadvantages, like low resolution in the low density region. There are also maybe some noise that can be due to the particle distribution, and it was a bit younger compared to grid-based code, but today there are a lot of comparison between SPH and IMR, and they give very similar results. The third method is then combine both methods, and this is a moving mesh method, so like the AREPO code. So here is an animation of a test where it is a Kelvin-Helmholtz instability. And you see that in that case, the cells are moving. Okay, so in fact, the cells are attached to particles. So the particles are moving. And then at each time step, so a Voronoi tessellation is done, okay, to make this pattern of the cell distribution. And some flux are computed at cell interfaces. Okay. So again, it is naturally adaptive. The only drawback of this kind of method is that you need to do some tessellation very often, and this can be very time consuming. So I must stress now that all of these methods are used to study star formation in the ISM, and they currently integrate all the main physical processes. So radiative transfer, magnetic fields, of course, gravity, hydro, and also cosmic ray diffusion. Okay, so now I begin with the challenge of star formation. So the first one, I think you are already aware of it, is the star formation rate problem. So the star formation rate that is observed in the galaxy is a few solar mass per year. And if we make a rough estimate of the time it would need to convert all the dense gas in the galaxy into star, so within a freefall time, we end up with an expected star formation rate of about 500 solar mass per year, which is 100 times the observed value. So this has been called the Zuckerman-Evans catastrophe, and we need to find some mechanism to make star formation inefficient the galaxy. So we will review some of the mechanisms so in the following. Another properties of the ISM, as I already told you, is that when we observed, so at all scale in the galaxy, so at galaxy scale, in molecular clouds, within dense cores, and also at protostellar disk scale, we see evidence of magnetic fields, meaning that we need to follow the evolution of the magnetic field from the galactic scale down to the protostellar disk. A third properties is that so the medium is turbulent, and in particular, molecular clouds are in supersonic turbulence. So here is an example of dust emission maps so in Polaris, and you see all this complex structure which looks like a turbulent, let's say, structure. Now, if we look at the properties of molecular clouds here traced by CO clumps, and we see that they exhibit some power laws over decades in mass. So this is suggestive maybe of a turbulent cascade and of universality of the turbulence. And this has been shown so by Larson in 91, where he has compiled all the data of mass, length, velocity dispersion within molecular cloud. And what he showed that all molecular clouds fall along the same power law, where typically the velocity dispersion increase with the size of the molecular clouds, and the mass also increase with the size. And he inferred this relation for molecular clouds. So this tells us that, well, if turbulence is present, there may be a cascade from the large scale down to the smaller scales. Okay. So there have been some experiments to look at how turbulence cascades from the large scales down to the smaller scales. And if you consider a very simple experiment, so this has been done by Maclow et al. In 98. So they considered a turbulent box, okay, and then they let evolve the box, okay, without any, so they start from a turbulent state and let it evolve. And what they show is that within one turbulent crossing time, so the turbulent crossing time is the ratio between the size of the domain and the turbulent velocity. So within one crossing time, all the kinetic energy or turbulent energy is dissipated. And this is true for grid-based code, SPH code, and also for models which integrate magnetic fields, which means that, well, if turbulence is universal and at all scales, then we need a mechanism to maintain turbulence. So I invite you to read this nice review lecture by Klessen and Glover, where they estimate so the energy dissipation rate in the Milky Way. So it is typically 10 to the minus 27 arc per cubic centimeters per second. And then we need to find some mechanism that compensate this energy dissipation, so in the interstellar medium. So I think that Florent Renaud and Ivo Stryker, we speak about that later tomorrow and on Thursday. So there are various mechanisms that can help to inject energy. So there are large-scale phenomena like accretion onto the galaxy disk, so accretion-driven turbulence, or gravitational instability and spiral arms at the galactic disk scale. And there are also the stellar feedback like supernova explosion, H2 region, or protostellar jets, which are launched when in young protostars. So clearly here you see that when you want to study the energy injection, you need to connect the large scales with the smaller scales. Okay. So here I give two examples of numerical models that study energy injection in the ISM. So the first one is a kiloparsec box, which represents a portion of the galactic disk. So here you see edge-on view. So it's initially stratified. And in this paper by Enbel and Frigg, they inject some kinetic and thermal feedback via supernova explosion. And you see that, well, when a supernova explode, they drive some turbulence. They also thicken the galactic disk. And as a consequence, they lower star formation and also maintain the turbulence. A second experiment on the right, so it is ionization from a massive protostar, so simulation by Tremblin et al. So you consider a massive star here on the left that illuminates turbulent molecular clouds. And if radiation is strong, so it can ionize the gas, put some momentum, and then perturb the gas and drive some turbulence at even smaller scale. So these two experiments show you how we can drive turbulence with some stellar feedback. Now we can combine them both. So it's a recent work by Noé Brussy. So it's similar work than Enbel and Ifrig, where they consider a portion of the galactic disk. They use so supernova feedback and in addition H2 region and also the far UV heating. And what they show is that, well, when you account for this stellar feedback in the model, you are able to recover the expected star formation rate in Milky Way-like condition. So stellar feedback seems to be sufficient to explain the star formation rate in Milky Way-like galaxy. You see also that the feedback helps to thicken sorry, the galactic disk and to remove gas here from the galactic plane. However, this can be not sufficient, as for instance for starburst galaxy. And Brussy et al. Have shown that in that case, we need to invoke other turbulence driving mechanism, like a large scale turbulence driving, which should come from, let's say, gravitational instabilities at the galactic disk scale. So they perform similar models, but this time driving the turbulence at the box scale. Okay, so you see this large turbulent motion. So in that case, it is a 2D driving. And you see that, well, this extra turbulent support lowers star formation. There is much less stars that are forming. And if you look at, so we can go maybe faster. If you look at then the star formation, so Kennicott-Schmidt relation in this type of simulation. So in red, it is a simulation with only supernova. And here with two levels of turbulence driving, you see that for Milky Way type galaxies, it is okay to consider only a supernova and H2 region, but clearly for more massive galaxies, we need to account for this external feedback. And if we look at the injected power, you see that, well, at small column density, supernovae are dominating the energy injection. But if you go to larger column density, then clearly we need this large scale driving. So After this introduction about energy injection and star formation rate regulation, I will now go to molecular clouds formation and the formation of dense clouds. So as you have probably seen already with François Boulanger, and I already spoke briefly about it, so when we look at the balance between the heating and cooling mechanism in the interstellar medium, we end up with this equilibrium curve. So here there are different equilibrium curves at various locations in the galactic disk, but you see that all these equilibrium curves exhibit this feature here, where the pressure decreases as a function of increasing density. So clearly it is an unstable state, and you can show analytically, sorry, there's a typo, it's from field 65, that if you have this condition of decreasing pressure as a function of the density, you are in an unstable state, and then the gas will tend to go into two stable states at pressure equilibrium, which represent the WNM, which is diffuse and hot, and the CNM, which is dense and cold. So you can apply this cooling function, so heating and cooling, sorry, terms in numerical simulation, and look at how molecular clouds form. So for instance, at galactic scale by interaction with spiral arms, so this simulation by Dobbs et al. So you see here all the molecular clouds that form in spiral-like structure, which is quite consistent with what is observed in spiral galaxy. Or you can also go to smaller scales, so consider colliding flows. So I think that Frédéric Mott already spoke about it in her lecture. So here, colliding flows should represent, for instance, two supernova remnants that collide and so create this shock front and perturb the gas. And you see here the evolution. So it's a simulation by Audit and Bell. So you have two colliding flows, and you see all these dense structures which are formed, which are in fact the molecular clouds. So you can look at the properties, physical properties within this kind of simulation. And if we do that, we see that if we look at the pressure density diagram, we see that, well, the gas is first shocked, okay? So it follows Rankine-Ugonio curve, and then it goes into the unstable state, and then goes back into the stable WNM and CNM phases. And you see, if you look at the PDF of the density, you see clearly evidence of the WNM and the CNM. So if we focus on the CNM phase, so in the work by Sori et al., so it's a similar work than colliding flow, except that in that case, turbulence is driven in the Fourier space. What they did is that they consider, they look at the properties of this CNM club, so the dense club, and they look at, well, the mass radius relation and the velocity dispersion radius relation, and they found that, well, if you fit this data, you match quite very well the Larson relation, and also the mass spectrum are similar to the ones observed for cyclones that I presented before. So this kind of indicate that, well, this mechanism of molecular clouds formation through thermal instability and energy injection at a large scale is consistent with what is observed, at least for the molecular clouds properties. So now we will go to smaller scale and look at the formation of a gravitationally unstable structure within molecular clouds. In fact, we'll look at the formation of the dense cores. So if we consider individual molecular clouds, and then we will consider only gravity and thermal support. So if you do the virial analysis, you end up with this critical mass, which depends on the temperature of the medium and on the density. So the higher the density, the smaller this critical mass. So if the mass is larger than this critical mass, then the cloud will collapse. For Milky Way-like condition, you see that this mass is about 1 to 3 solar masses. And this is quite consistent with the peak of the core mass function that Frédéric presented at about 1 solar mass. Okay. Now, if we account for turbulence, you can view the turbulence as some extra support because a continuous injection of energy by turbulence will destroy the overdensity that can be created. And thus, it regulates, let's say, the formation of this overdensity. So you can view it as a modified sound speed at very small scales, and then compute the critical Lissing mass, mass as a function of this modified sound speed. So these are what we call the gravo-turbulent model. So there are a lot of analytical work in that field that has been done. So I encourage you to read all that. And you see that, well, turbulence contributes to support the cloud. And finally, if we consider magnetic field, and we do the virial analysis with magnetic field, so here with the magnetic component, and if we consider only magnetic field and gravity, we can show that there is a critical mass, again, above which clouds can collapse. And if the mass is less than this critical mass, it cannot collapse because it is supported by magnetic field. Magnetic field is too strong and prevents the contraction. So you can then provide this quantity mu, which is the mass to flux ratio over the critical mass to flux ratio, this quantity. And if mu is larger than 1, then the cloud is not supported by magnetic field and can collapse. And you see that then you can rewrite this term as a function of this mu parameter, and you end up with this virial analysis, let's say, where you see that the thermal and kinetic support balance the gravity, and that the gravity has been diluted by the magnetic fields. Okay, so it does not cancel the effect of gravity, but it dilutes it, and the stronger the magnetic field, the weaker the gravity. So it will delay, in fact, gravity. So to illustrate this, I show you here some numerical experiment by Federat in 2015. So here we consider a portion of a molecular cloud, okay, which is a few parsec in size. This molecular cloud is isothermal, okay, and we apply periodic boundary condition. So we assume that this portion of the gas is embedded in a molecular cloud, and we can consider it as, let's say, a periodic domain, okay. So Federat has performed 4 types of calculation. So the first one, here we take turbulent medium and add the gravity. So we turn on the gravity. And so it's decaying turbulence, in fact. The second one, turbulence will be continuously driven at the box scale. So using some driving scheme, so the energy is injected at the box scale and continuously injected during the simulation. So it will show the effect of energy injection. Then it is the same calculation, but with a magnetic field. So magnetic field with an amplitude coherent with what is observed in the Milky Way. And finally, protostellar jets will be included, because in fact, in this calculation with self-gravity, we cannot follow the collapse down to the stellar scales, and thin particles are introduced. So thin particles represent a portion of the gas that is gravitationally unstable and collapse. So in fact, these are the dense cores that are forming in the calculation. So then from this thin particle, you can apply some subgrid modeling as it is done on galactic scale, and add some stellar feedback. So in that case, it will be protostellar jets. So if we now look at the evolution, so first with only gravity, you see that star formation is occurring quickly, and that star forms very efficiently. In 0.7 million years, we reach star formation efficiency of 20%. Now, when turbulence is continuously driven, you see that the structure changes completely, so it is more spread. And that the time to reach a star formation efficiency of 20% is 1.5 million years. with magnetic field, you see that it is even longer to form stars, so 3.4 million years, and also the top, let's say the structure of the filaments has changed. It is much more diffuse. And with protostellar jets, you see that there is much more turbulent motion. You see clearly here the protostellar jets, which are launched by the Singh particle and which maintain turbulence. So it's a bit here an extreme case because of the periodic boundary conditions. So the energy that goes there then re-enters in the medium here. Okay, but still, it shows you that, well, when we add more physics, so first turbulence, then magnetic field, and then stellar feedback, we can make star formation much slower. So now we can look at the star formation rates in this type of calculation. And so here you have the star formation efficiency as a function of time. So you see that, turbulence, magnetic field delay star formation, but do not suppress it. And in particular, if you look at the star formation rate, it is increasing function with time. But then when we add protostellar jets, you see that star formation efficiency is, let's say, slower, and the star formation rate is relatively consistent with observation. If you plot it in the Kennicott-Schmidt diagram, you have all the four simulation here. So red with gravity only, then with turbulence, magnetic field, and the three additional effect. And you see that you lower by more than one order of magnitude the star formation rate. So this illustrates that, when we add more physics and we account for the main component in the ISM, then we can lower the star formation rate by more than one order of magnitude and then get value which are more consistent with observations. Also, what we can do from this type of calculation is provide some statistics, for instance, PDF of the column density. So first PDF of the column density when stars are not forming. So you see here this log normal shape. I think that Frédéric Mott already spoke about it. And you see that, when stars are forming, then this power law are developing, and this power law are suggestive of the gravity that takes over here at high densities. So we can directly compare this kind of PDF with observations. So in all what I've presented before, so first molecular clots formation and then dense core formation, you have seen that we do it step by step. So first we consider kiloparsec box, look at molecular clots formation, and then we consider a parsec box, so molecular clots, and look at dense core formation. But today, thanks to the increasing computation power with supercomputer, we are now able to do zoom calculation directly from the galactic disk down to dense cores. So here is an example of a calculation by N. Bell in 2018 using the Ramsey code, which goes from kiloparsec down to resolution of 10 to the minus 3 parsec. So here's an illustration of the huge dynamical range that you can achieve in this kind of calculation. And you see that here all the small entities are molecular clots or even dense core, which are formed in this kind of calculation. So this calculation is similar to what I've presented before. So portion of the galactic disk with injection of energy, it is regulated by supernova explosion. What we can do on this kind of calculation is look at the properties of the dense clump that are formed. So in particular, we can look at the mass radius relation, so which is, let's say, Larson-like. On the contrary, you see that maybe the velocity dispersion as a function of the mass is roughly, so show no clear trend. We can also have a look to the halfenic Mach number in this kind of core. So initially there is a magnetic field at galactic scale, and then the magnetic field follows the evolution, gets amplified as the gas is compressed, and you see that we achieve halfenic Mach number, which are transhalvenic to subhalvenic in a star-forming core, meaning that magnetic field is expected to be strong in this kind of core, And you see it by looking at this mu parameter. So for mu larger than one, the cloud will collapse. For mu less than one, it cannot collapse. And you see that, well, the clouds that can collapse have a mu that is larger than one, but still less than 10. So which indicates, again, a strong magnetic field. We can also look at the statistics of the mass, so the mass distribution of this kind of cores that are formed. So here are two different mass functions. The one for the supercritical core, so which are not supported by magnetic field. So you see here three different mass functions for three different numerical resolutions, so coarse resolution, intermediate, and high resolution. So you see that there is not a clear convergence of the core mass function, but still we see that we recover this log normal distribution with a peak at around one solar mass. This is also true for the core which have a virial parameter, let's say, less than one, so that are gravitationally unstable. And if you remember the talk by Frédéric Mott, she talked about this core mass function, so at least for the low mass part, which exhibit this log normal distribution. So here, for instance, in this Herschel observation by Knives et al. 2010, where they show that the observed core mass function peaks around one solar mass. And also, it is very similar to the shape of the stellar initial mass function. So you might now wonder if there is a connection between the core mass function and the AMF. So is the AMF already inputted in the core mass function? So in what will follow, I will consider individual dense core of a given mass, and I will look at their collapse. So I will not speak about the high mass tail so in this lecture, but I will be happy to discuss it later. So I will make a first break with this takeaway message and take some questions. So I think I've illustrated that magnetic fields and turbulence help to regulate the star formation rate, but it is not sufficient. We need clearly stellar feedback. The picture seems to be quite well consistent with observations. We still have a lot of things to do still. So it's connect the galactic scale and dense core more systematically. So do more models, so we need more CPU time. And also we need to progressively add stellar feedback in this kind of models, so not only supernova. And also we need to apply this numerical framework to different conditions, so other than Milky Way-like conditions. Okay, so if there are some questions, I can make a first break.
There are already a few on Slack. So for instance, why is the Jinks lens used to refine the AMR cell size? Other physical length scales are unimportant?
Well, it's because we are interested in star formation, so in gravitational collapse, and the typical length so of the gravitational instability is the Jinks length. So we focus on the gravitational instability. Of course, if we are interested in supernova remnant propagation, then we will refine, for instance, on velocity and density gradients. But for protostellar collapse, it's mainly the Jinks mass or Jinks length.
Thank you. Then there is one. This is about a simulation assuming 2D turbulence. Is there any evidence of an inverse turbulence cascade from observations as expected for 2D turbulence?
That's a good question. I don't know. I know that Noé is in the audience and maybe in the coffee session after, I can also speak about that. I have no idea. What I can say is that in this kind of simulation, the turbulence is already driven at the box size. So it's hard to have an inverse cascade at larger scale because we are already at the largest scales.
About the dilution of gravity by magnetic field, does it assume that there is only turbulent magnetic field, meaning macroscopically organized field?
It does not really assume something on the topology on the magnetic field. It assumes something on the magnetic flux at a large scale. So how much magnetic flux there is at the core scale. Okay?
Okay.
So it's more the large scale magnetic field.
Do you want to take a few other questions or?
Yes, I can take.
Yeah. Okay, so we have three of them still.
Okay.
We have in the core mass function plots, the peaks seem to move to the left with increasing resolution. Can we say we have reached the best resolution yet, or is it still going to move slightly to the left?
This is a good question. we don't know. Clearly, it is not converged. But I think I'm not sure with this number. But if the peak is moving less than what we expect, and we increase the resolution by a factor 2, we can say that at some point we can reach a convergence. But clearly, we need to go to even higher resolution in that case.
Mm-hmm.
It's not yet settled.
Okay. Maybe last one. how sensitive are the simulations on the initial conditions, and how are the initial conditions defined or motivated? Are they based on observations?
For which kind of calculations?
This one don't give any precision, but I would guess, in the last one you showed, because that's one of the last questions.
Maybe not the last one, because here turbulence is self-regulated by supernovae. Meaning that there is a supernovae rate that is consistent with the galactic measurements. Okay, but for the other kind of simulation, so this simulation, what people do usually is that, so they choose a box size, so of a few parsecs, and then they drive the turbulence to a level that is consistent with the Larson relations. Okay, so depending on the box size, you apply this amount of turbulence driving. So the larger the box, the larger the amplitude of the driving. Okay.
Okay. Thank you.
Okay. So now we will go to smaller scales. So the collapse of the dense core. So in that case, so there is again a challenge. And of course, is that it is again multi-physics and multi-scale. So here is another illustration of the density profile in a collapsing core. So we start from the dense core and then go to the stellar scale, so 10 to the minus 3 AU. So you see the density that increased by 20 orders of magnitude. And if you look at the corresponding optical depth profile, you see that we also have to deal with two different regimes for the radiative transfer, optically thin here in the envelope, and then here optically thick in the densest part of the collapsing core. So again, we need to have tools that take into account this high range of spatial and physical scales, and also to deal with this different regime for the radiative transfer. I think that most of you are not familiar with star formation, so I will briefly explain how we think star formation proceeds, at least for the low mass stars. So there is an empirical star formation evolutionary sequence that can be derived according to some observed quantities. So for instance, the shape of the spectral energy distribution. So we start from the dense core, which is radiates like a black body at about 10K. Then the dense core collapses under its own gravity to form a central object. So we enter into the protostellar phase and in the class zero phase. But at this stage, the mass of the envelope is much larger than the mass of the central object. So we are still dominated by the emission of the envelope. So it radiates still like a black body, but we can discriminate the class zero phase with the pre-stellar phase by the fact that there are some accretion and ejection motion associated to the formation of the central object. So if we see evidence of protostellar jets and outflows, and we are in the class zero phase. So then the envelope gets accreted or ejected by the central system. And when the mass of the stellar object becomes larger than the mass of the envelope, we enter into the class one phase where we begin to see the emission from the central protostar. Then the protostar enters the pre-main sequence evolution. So this is the T3 phase. There is no more envelope left. So, and we end up with a system made of a star and a protoplanetary disk where maybe planet could form. Then the HCD show evidence of the stellar radiation, and then here an infrared excess due to the presence of the disk. So in what I will speak after, I will focus on the transition between the pre-stellar and the protostellar phase. And this transition can be divided into four steps. So these steps are valid still since Larson again. So Larson 69. So he has performed the first numerical model of a collapsing core, and this picture is still valid today. So how does it proceed, the collapse? So we start with the collapse of the dense core, with what we call the first collapse, which proceeds isothermally. So sorry, here you have the run of the temperature as a function of the density in the collapsing core. So the first collapse is done isothermally because the dust can radiate the compressional energy due to the gravitational contraction. So this works very well until we reach densities of 10 to the minus 13 grams per cc. And at this density, the dust becomes opaque to its own radiation. So meaning that the radiation is trapped and the gas begins to heat up. So the effective gamma becomes 5 hertz. So this is the adiabatic index in that case. And we form an object in hydrostatic equilibrium, which is called the first Larson core. So it has a size of about 10 AU, temperature of 100 Kelvin. This first Larson core has a lifetime very short, a few thousand years. So it is predicted by the theory, but it has not yet been convincingly, let's say, observed. So there are a few very good candidates, but we are not yet sure that these are first Larson core. So this first Larson core will accrete matter, so it will then increase its temperature, contract. So the temperature will increase until we will reach 2000 K. And at 2000 K, H2 dissociation will start. So H2 dissociation is an endothermal reaction, so it needs to take some energy to break the H2 molecule. So what it will do, in fact, it will take the gravitational energy in order to break the H2 molecule. So it's like a fridge. And you end up with effective gamma of 1.1, which is less than the critical gamma of 4/3, which is needed to have gravitational collapse, okay, where Jeans mass decreases with the density. So you have a second collapse that begins, which happens proceed very quickly because the free fall time associated to this density is a few hundred years. So we are almost done. And then when central density close to stellar density are reached, we form what we call the second Larson core, which is in fact the protostar. Okay. So here I will show you calculation that first go to the first core stage and then to the second core. What we know is that to each of these stages, so first core, second core, there are some components which are associated, like a disk, an accretion disk, a low velocity, wide opening angle outflow, a jet also very well collimated that is driven from the central protostar. And as you will see, the development of these different components, disk formation, outflow formation is highly dependent on MHD effect. And a good question, a question that we need to answer now, is how the disk is forming. When does it form? Is it before the protostar or after the formation of the protostar? And all this have implication on the formation of planets. So the condition within the protostellar disk will determine the condition within the protoplanetary disk. So if we now consider what is happening within a collapsing dense core, we can look at the effect of thermal support, centrifugal support, and magnetic support. So if we look at the evolution of the ratio between the thermal energy and the gravitational energy, we see that, this ratio decreases when the radius decreases, meaning that the thermal support becomes less and less important as collapse proceeds. On the contrary, if you consider some initial rotation, which can be inherited from the large-scale turbulence, and you assume that angular momentum is conserved, then you see that the ratio between the rotational energy and the gravitational energy increases when the radius decreases, meaning that the rotational energy will get even more and more important as the collapse will proceed. for the magnetic field, if you assume that the magnetic field is perfectly coupled to the gas, and so that there is conservation of the magnetic flux, you can show that the ratio between the magnetic and the gravitational energy is constant and does not depend on the radius. It depends only on the initial mass to flux ratio, meaning that if magnetic field is strong at the beginning, it will stay strong all the way during protostellar collapse. And I remind you that observations tend to indicate that, well, this mass to flux ratio should be, let's say, between 2 and 5, so a strong magnetic field. So what are the consequences of all this? So first, for the rotation, so at some point, the centrifugal force will become dominant. So we will form, so there will be a flattening of the envelope and then formation of a centrifugally supported structure, what I will call a disk in the remaining of the talk. So when I speak about a disk, it is something that is supported by the rotation. For the magnetic field, so if the magnetic field is strong at the beginning, so we will have first collapse along magnetic field line. So we will create a hover density here in the equatorial plane, and then a collapse here along the radial direction. So this will pinch the magnetic field line, as you see, and you will have this hourglass shape for the magnetic field line topology, which is quite observed in star-forming region. So with this pinching of the magnetic field line, there will be also a density enhancement close to the midplane, and we will form what we call a pseudo-disk. So it's not a disk. It is a structure which looks like a disk, but not rotationally supported. Another effect that I will illustrate just after is that magnetic fields can also provide efficient braking to the rotation of the cloud. So now there are two main challenges when we consider dense core collapse. The first issue is about angular momentum conservation. So here is a diagram of the specific angular momentum as a function of the radius for different star-forming regions, more or less advanced. So if we focus here on the left part of the plot, so below the dense core size, you see that, well, first, angular momentum seems to be more or less conserved, down to scale of about 100 AU. But then angular momentum decreases with the radius. And for instance, the angular momentum contained in the solar system is much less than the one observed in dense core. So this indicates that we need to find some way to transport the angular momentum from the inner part to the envelope during the star formation process. Another problem is about magnetic flux. So if you consider that a magnetic field is frozen with the fluid and that you have a magnetic flux conservation, you take magnetization that is consistent with a galactic measurement, and you compute the magnetic field that will end up into a star. And you end up with a magnetic field in the star which will be 10 to the 10 Gauss. So this is not what is observed. It is unrealistic. We observe magnetic field within star which are the order of a kilo Gauss, so 10 to the 3 Gauss. So as for angular momentum, we need to find some mechanism to regulate magnetic flux transport from the large scale down to the stellar scales. So for that, clearly, we need a numerical experiments to look at the evolution of collapsing dense core. So here, I will show you what are the typical initial conditions for dense core collapse. So as I told you, we will assume that the dense core detached from the evolution of the surrounding. We will be in the isolated dense core paradigm because the free fall time simply is shorter than the dynamical time evolution of the molecular cloud. So then the numerical experiment uses very simple initial conditions. So these are so mass of the order of one to a few hundred solar masses for isolated dense core. The initial density is very simple. So it's either uniform or Bonnet-Rebert-like, so meaning that we have a plateau and then a r to the minus 2 profile. So I forgot to say that these cores are spherical, in spherical geometry. Then a uniform temperature is applied, so at about 10K. We can add some initial rotation, so given by this beta parameter, ratio between the rotational and gravitational energy, so either solid body rotation or differential rotation. We can also add some perturbation in the system initially, either azimuthal density perturbation to favor spiral arms apparition, or we can also apply some turbulent initial velocity field to mimic the turbulence coming from the larger scale. And finally, we assume that the magnetic field is organized on larger scale initially, threading the cloud, and we set its amplitude by the mu parameter, which is the mass to flux ratio over the critical mass to flux ratio. And as I told you, mu should be, let's say, between 2 and 10, relatively strong. So now I will present you simulation that we presented the state of the art more than 10 years ago, when magnetic field was introduced in this kind of calculation. So isolated dense core that is gravitationally unstable. So here are the results of collapsing one solar mass dense core with initial rotation, first in the hydro case, okay? So without magnetic field. Here we see the evolution of the density in the equatorial plane and view from the edge. So if we look at the evolution of the system, you see that, well, we form a disk that is relatively large, a few hundred AU in size, and the disk is relatively thin, and you see that the disk is fragmenting, okay, in about five fragments. So this kind of model integrate relative transfer, meaning that they integrate an equation for the radiative energy. So as the column density is much less here in the vertical direction, so photons can escape here in that direction. So the gas can cool and then reach smaller Jeans mass. Okay, so this enhances the fragmentation. And it's a good way to solve the angular momentum issue, because then the angular momentum is spread, so split into this fragment. The problem is that when high resolution observation appeared, we do not observe this large and massive disk. So we are thinking about the effect of magnetic field. So now I will do the same calculation as before with a mu of 5. Initially, the magnetic field will be aligned with the rotational axis. And this is ideal MHD, meaning that the fluid is frozen, the magnetic field is frozen with the fluid. So if we look at the evolution, you see that it is much different compared to the hydro evolution. So there is almost no rotation, so no disk is formed. You see this structure here, which looks like a disk, but it is not a disk, it is the pseudo-disk, okay? It's not rotationally supported. So if you make an observation of this, you may think it's a disk if you just have continuum data, but if you can measure the rotation, you will see that in fact it is in folie. Also, what you see is that we form this wide angle, low velocity outflow at the first core scale, which is consistent with some observation. So you see that the magnetic field has changed drastically the picture. So no more disk, no more rotation. So this is because of magnetic breaking. So if you imagine the magnetic field threading the cloud, so in the central part, the rotation will bend the magnetic field line. And if the magnetic field is strong, it will tend to realign, okay? So it will slow down the gas rotation, and then angular momentum will be transported from the inner part to the envelope along the magnetic field line. So this is what we call magnetic breaking. And in that case, with idle MHD, magnetic breaking was so efficient that no more disks were formed and there was no fragmentation. And this was a problem because we know that disks should form at some point because we observe them. And we know also that fragmentation should occur because we observe stars in multiple systems. So in order to bring back the disk, a lot of effort has been done in the past 10 years and different mechanisms has been studied to form a disk, like for instance the late formation at the end of the class zero, when there is no more envelope, so there is no more material to accept the angular momentum from the central part, so magnetic breaking becomes inefficient, or a misalignment between the magnetic field and the initial rotation axis, so there are no reason for both to be aligned, and observations tend to indicate that it is a random distribution. And when you have a misalignment, then you can show that it can reduce the efficiency of the magnetic breaking. A third effect is what we call turbulent reconnection. So if you assume that there are some reconnection events happening on small scale, then on larger scale, on the turbulent eddies, you can view it as a turbulent diffusion and that can diffuse magnetic field. However, it's very hard to measure in a numerical experiment. And there is a last process that has been studied, which is non-ideal MHD, and which is for me the most robust effect for disk formation. So what is non-ideal MHD? Non-ideal MHD is when we consider a non-perfect coupling between the gas and dust mixture and the magnetic field. Because in the neutral medium, as it is, so in its an acronym, in name, it is neutral, meaning that there are more neutral than ionized species. But still, there are enough charges to be coupled to the magnetic field, but not perfectly. And if you consider the diffusion of electrons onto neutral, so ohmic diffusion, the diffusion of ions onto a neutral, ambipolar diffusion, or the Hall effect, which is the drift between the positively and negatively charged particle, you can account for this non-ideal effect, so non-perfect coupling. So here is the induction equation that you can obtain in a monofluid formalism, where you see in black the ideal part, where U is the velocity of the neutral. And then we need to correct, because what should enter in the induction equation is the velocity of the charged pieces. So you correct it with the non-ideal term, ohmic diffusion, Hall effect, and ambipolar diffusion. So you see that first, the Hall effect and the ambipolar diffusion can be viewed as a V cross B term, so like the U cross B, meaning that they will rearrange the magnetic field line at a different velocity than the fluid velocity. Then the Hall effect and the ambipolar diffusion can provide some reconnection, and the ohmic diffusion can also provide some magnetic flux diffusion. So clearly, this will affect the transport of magnetic flux in collapsing core. Now, all the game is to know the amplitude of this eta parameter, so what we call the resistivity. And for that, we need to know the ionization state of the collapsing material. And for that, we need to know the gas grain chemistry. So here is an example of a work by Marchand et al. So he did, Pierre Marchand did his PhD in Lyon a few years ago. So he designed a reduced chemical network which accounts for the main charge carriers in a collapsing dense core. So mainly the ions of the most abundant element, and then some molecular and metallic ions. Also, dust grains, which follow the MRN dust size distribution that Karin spoke about yesterday. And the grains can be positively and negatively charged with only one charge. Then we account for other effects at high temperature, like dust evaporation and thermal ionization above 1,000 K. So then from this network, we look for equilibrium solution for a given density and temperature. So if you assume that the temperature follows this evolution as a function of the density, so isothermal, adiabatic, quasi-isothermal, and then adiabatic, you can compute the equilibrium abundances, and then what we call the conductivities, which depend on the abundances of each species, and then the resistivities from the conductivities. And here you see the evolution of the resistivities as a function of the density in a collapsing core. So again, in the red, we have ambipolar diffusion, in the blue, the Hall effect, and in green, the ohmic diffusion. And you see that, well, if we want to know which effect is dominant, well, we have a problem. The problem is that all effects will dominate at some point. So first ambipolar diffusion, then Hall effect, and finally ohmic diffusion. So clearly, if we want to treat correctly the non-ideal MHD effect, then we need to account for all these three effects in the model. What we have shown also is that in order to have a convergence on the resistivity, we need to describe the dust size distribution with at least 5 bins, because it is very sensitive to the size distribution of the grains. The grains becomes the main charge carriers here at high densities. Okay, so now I will present similar model as before, but with non-ideal MHD and only ambipolar diffusion. So I will focus here on this scale, so the first core formation. So why don't I take into account the Hall effect? It's because it's harder to implement and it has been implemented later than the ambipolar diffusion. Okay, so with ambipolar diffusion, what we can show is that the evolution of the magnetic field is very different than the one with ideal MHD. So here is at a given snapshot, the magnetic field amplitude as a function of the density in an ideal MHD case and in a case with ambipolar diffusion. So you see that with ideal MHD, as the fluid, so the magnetic field is perfectly coupled with the fluid, the magnetic field is compressed with the fluid, so with the density. So it increases with the density. With ambipolar diffusion, you see that there is a plateau here at 0.1 Gauss. So this is because ambipolar diffusion starts to dominate here at a high density, and it prevents any further magnetic flux accumulation. Okay, so as soon as the magnetic field gets amplified, it is immediately diffused by ambipolar diffusion, and we stay at about 0.1 Gauss. So if the magnetic field is less strong in the central part, then the efficiency of the magnetic breaking is less because the magnetic tension is much less. So this then provides a smaller magnetic field here in the central part, and then we can form disk in this kind of calculation. So here in the I-line case, you see that we form a disk which is relatively small initially, but when we consider a misalignment of 40 degrees, you see that we form a nice disk with this spiral pattern of a size of about 50 AU. If we look at the properties of this disk, interestingly, we see that the disk are dominated by the thermal pressure. So here is the map of the plasma beta within the disk. So all what is blue to purple is dominated by the thermal pressure. And you see that this corresponds very well to the region of the disk. We see also that the magnetic field in the disk is essentially vertical. Okay, there is no toroidal nor radial component. And this is quite important because these two conditions, plasma beta and magnetic field topology, are initial conditions that we can directly inject in the studies of protoplanetary disk evolution. So you see that here we are at the point where we can connect star formation with planet formation. So we have performed a lot of additional calculations to look at, for instance, the effect of an initial turbulence initially. And what we find is that with ambipolar diffusion, we have a very good convergence of the results. So whatever the initial conditions are, if you look at the mass to flux profile for various initial conditions with initial turbulence or an angle, so for mu equals 2 or 5, you see that, well, we have very similar profiles. We have always the plateau at about 0.1 Gauss, so with initial turbulence or with only initial rotation. And we have always the same pattern, so formation of a disk, formation of spiral arms. So this might be a spurious effect, since in that case we do not form a thin particle. So normally matter should collapse further close to the so at the second core stage. So if we account for it, we do not see this strong spiral pattern, and the disk is a bit smaller. And also you see that we form this outflow. So we have a very good convergence, which was not obtained, I must stress, with ideal MHD. So now I will go to even higher resolution, so below the AU resolution, and go to the second collapse and protostar formation. So this calculation has been performed again with Ramsès, and now we add the ohmic diffusion on top of the ambipolar diffusion. We also account for H2 dissociation using a non-ideal gas equation of state from Saumon, Chabrier, and Von Horn. And we use very high resolution, so of 10 to the minus 4 AU. So this means that we have 21 level of IMR in the model. So we have refined more than 20 times the grid to reach this very high resolution. So here I compare the magnetic field amplitude as a function of the density. So ideal MHD in red, so as expected, magnetic field is amplified all the way down to the protostellar scale. So we end up with 10 to the 6 Gauss in the forming protostar, so not realistic. But if we look at what is happening with non-ideal MHD, you see that we still have the plateau at about 0.1 Gauss, but then at high temperature, the gas gets fully ionized. So we are back to ideal MHD approximation, but with a weak magnetic field, okay? Because the magnetic field stayed here at the force core scale. So meaning that the magnetic field is less strong, and then it gets amplified, but to a reasonable value of about a kilogauss in the stellar interior. So this seems to be an indication that, well, the magnetic flux problem seems to be resolved when we account for this non-ideal MHD effect. If we look at the magnetic field line topology around the second core, with ideal MHD, you see that we have essentially this strong poloidal magnetic field line with a strong magnetic breaking. And with non-ideal MHD, you see that the magnetization is much less, and then that we have a toroidal field that is generated by the rotation here close to the central protostar. So this is generation of toroidal field just by the rotation as the magnetic field is weak. If we look at the plasma beta, we see that all the region of the second collapse correspond to region dominated by the thermal pressure, so where magnetic field is weak. We can now look at the properties of the disk forming this kind of calculation. So with ideal MHD, no disk, too strong magnetic breaking. But with non-ideal MHD, you see that we form a disk. So the disk has a size of about 0.1 AU. If we look at the properties of the disk, we see that it is tumoray unstable, meaning that it is gravitationally unstable, so prone to fragment. It is also in Keplerian rotation. The problem is that we had to stop the calculation at this stage, okay? So only, let's say, 1 month after the formation of the protostar, because we are now limited by the integration time step, the numerical model, and 1 second in the computer corresponds to 1 second in the real life, okay? So if we want to integrate the dynamics over 1,000 years, then we would need 1,000 years of CPU time, so it is currently impossible to integrate this model further. So what I mean by that is that, well, you are seeing that we can form a disk at large scale around the first core, so on 50 to 100 AU scale. And we can also form another disk which has different properties, so meaning essentially a toroidal field and that is gravitationally unstable around the second core, but which is much smaller, 0.1 AU. So now all the question is to know how the two disks connect. Is it the disk around the second core that accretes and grows with time, expand to a 50 AU scale, or do we form the two disks independently and then they merge later in the evolution? So these are still open questions. So I will maybe take another question. Just remind you what I've shown is that disk formation protostellar collapse is highly dependent on the physics that is included. We have seen that clearly magnetic field changes completely the picture, and that we need non-ideal MHD in order to solve both the angular momentum problem and the magnetic flux problem. We have shown that also with MHD, we can launch these outflows and jet. I've not shown here jet launching. And this is also consistent with observation. And with this kind of model, we can maybe calibrate feedback model on larger scale for protostellar jets. So a lot of things needs to be done. So like a longer term evolution, both at the first core and second core scales. We might also revise the isolated paradigm to consider what is the effect of late accretion or the effect of streamers, which are now commonly observed in star-forming region, and clearly also provide a parametric study of second collapse. So we need to explore the wide mass range of initial mass for the dense cores. Okay, so if there are some questions, Nathalie?
Sorry, I lost my mouse. So just maybe two of them. So you have a few some time for the last part. Does the non-uniform magnetic field in the initial condition So meaning power spectrum of magnetic field with different strengths in different scales have the same impact.
This has not been well studied. So in particular, just if you consider the initial perturbation, what people consider are either initial perturbation in the velocity or in the density, but they are not coherent. Okay. So clearly what we need to do more systematically is take the initial condition from a large scale, let's say simulation with a coherent magnetic field density and velocity fields. So it has not yet been well studied, the effect of a non-coherent magnetic field. But what we show is that magnetic field is strong and seems to be well organized at dense core scales.
And the last one, what does set the scales where only diffusion, Hall effect, and amplitude diffusion dominate?
So it is basically the when the ionization is low, is still low, so we are not ionized, and that collision between ions and neutrons are not sufficient to provide a good coupling. So in our case, what we show is that when dust dominate the charges, dust are heavy particles, so all the charge are on the dust. Okay, and since the dust, I will show that later, are relatively big, they are less coupled to the gas. So meaning that the evolution of the charged pieces is decoupled from the gas evolution.
Okay, thanks. So you have 10, maximum 15 minutes for your last part if you want to have time to take a few questions.
Okay. Okay. So I will go briefly on the cluster formation. It's just to illustrate how physics change the picture, and in particular the emerging initial mass function in numerical model, but there is no consensus on the origin yet of the universality of the initial mass function. There are a few mechanisms that can be invoked, but we need clearly more work. So first example is a simulation by Matthew Bates, so SPH simulation, so collapse of a 500 solar mass dense core. You see here the density evolution, and you see so it goes down to resolution below an AU, so it accounts for radiative transfer, so it accounts for the accretion luminosity down to the resolution limit, and you see that well, stars are forming here along filaments, and at the end we form a cluster of stars. Some stars might be ejected of the system, and you see here all the stars that are forming here quite efficiently. If you look at the temperature evolution, in that case, you see that once stars are formed and go, so we reach very small scales, you see that the temperature increases quite efficiently. And if the temperature is increasing, then the genes length or the genes mass will also increase, meaning that we will prevent fragmentation and prevent further the formation of smaller mass object with this accretion luminosity heating. And you see here, it's quite very strong, so it affects almost all of the star-forming regions. Another example, so work by Antoine Verlier, who just defended his PhD thesis. So here we consider a cloud of a few thousand solar masses, and he uses some stellar feedback, so H2 radiation and protostellar jets, so associated to thin particles. And if we look at the evolution, you see that, well, stars are formed, then they launch these protostellar jets, so they maintain a certain level of turbulence and disperse the gas, and then when massive stars form, H2 the ionization front just pushes the gas out of the central part and should make an end of the star formation process. So you see here clearly how stellar feedback affect the evolution of the cluster. And if you look at the emerging initial mass function, so in the first case, with the calculation by Bate, So if you consider a simple recipe for the radiative transfer, meaning a barotropic equation of state, so this is what I shown at the beginning, where you have a simple relation for the temperature as a function of the density, so isothermal and then adiabatic. Okay, so you have only one temperature possible for one density. You see that we form a lot of low mass protostar and much more than what is observed with the IMF here. Okay, now if we account for radiative transfer, you see that, well, thanks to radiative heating, we form much less small mass object because of the heating provided by radiative transfer. And now we have a shape of the EMF which resembles the one of the observed one. However, it's not yet converged. So if we continue to integrate this kind of calculation, we can show that it will create a top-heavy IMF. So too many massive protostars. So radiative heating might be too strong. In another type of calculation, so recently by Sage and Federat, 2021, they did similar kind of calculation, but looking at the effect of stellar outflows on the IMF, and they showed that, well, with outflow, you can reduce the formation of the most massive protostar and then get a reasonable amount of low mass stars, where outflow seems to regulate the formation of both the high mass and low mass protostar. So you see that here clearly, when we add feedback in the models, then it affects directly the initial mass function in the models. There is not yet a definite answer that how we get this initial mass function. What we know is that there are as many initial mass functions as there are some feedback recipes. Okay. What needs to be done in this type of calculation is clearly look at the effect of non-ideal imagery. We have seen that for isolated core, we need to account for it. And second thing, I think, is that we need to account for more realistic initial conditions, because here we take again isolated very massive clouds that are very unstable and then collapse and might be not the most realistic, let's say, initial conditions. So a lot to be done. And finally, I would like to finish with some perspective, so, but maybe only one perspective of what I think the model should integrate in the coming years. And I think the dust evolution is the next ingredient to be implemented in numerical models. It already begins. So for instance, here by the work of Le Bruyer et al, so Hugo Le Bruyer implemented a dust solver in Ramsès. So what does this consist? So it consists of taking into account the drag between the gas and the dust. Okay, so the dust particles are much larger than the gas particles. So then there is a drag between the gas and the dust. And this drag is directly proportional to the stopping time, okay, which is the time that will need a dust grain to adapt to change of velocity in the gas. Okay, and you see that this stopping time is directly proportional to the size of the dust grain. Okay, so if you manage to make big grains, then they can be less coupled to the gas than the smaller grains. And the coupling is characterized by this Stokes parameter, which represents the ratio between the stopping time and the dynamical time. So for instance, in a turbulent box calculation, dynamical time is the crossing time. In a disk, it will be the orbital time. Okay. So if Stokes is about less than one, then you can have a decoupling of the dust grains with respect to the gas. So here is an example of a hydro collapse. You see here the gas density and here the dust density. Okay. The color coding has been done such that if there is no decoupling of the dust grain with respect to the gas, then we will have the same color coding. Okay. So if we look at the evolution, well, you see that we have a different evolution. You see that here, the gas, the envelope is depleted in dust compared to the gas, and that the disk has been enriched in dust material compared to the gas, meaning that we have a non-uniform dust-to-gas ratio in collapsing dense core, and that we can make initially dust-rich disk, and this can change, for instance, the resistivity. It can also change the planet formation, let's say, scenario with a high concentration of dust very early during the collapse. So you see that you can have this decoupling at the collapse stage. It's even more pronounced when we consider ideal magnetic field. Here, it is only neutral dust grains. And you see that, well, we have a strong enhancement of the dust here in the pseudo disk and also in the outflow cavity. So more work needs to be done. But here, what we can see is that, well, the dust size distribution can change by dynamical effect, so by decoupling. And in this work by Bo Zhao, they have shown that if you consider a different distribution than the MRN for the dust size, then you can change drastically the MHD resistivities and then the effect of non-ideal MHD resistivities. So in the MRN case, you see that in that case, we do not form a large disk, but when we get rid of the small grains, so we are enriched, for instance, in large grains, then ambipolar diffusion becomes stronger and we form the disk. So now all the game is to get self-consistently this the resistivity from the dust evolution. And also, these are preliminary work, sorry, but even within molecular clouds. So if you assume, so it's maybe a big assumption, but that there are already big grains in molecular clouds, like 10 micron grains, you can show that they can already decouple within molecular clouds. So here you see the evolution of the density. Here, the dust to gas ratio evolution of nanometer dust grain, and here of the 10 micron dust grains. And you see that, this small dust grains do not show strong variation in the dust ratio. But here, for the large grains, you see that you can have variation of about two orders of magnitudes or even more of the dust to gas ratio, meaning some here voids in large dust grains, and here a concentration of dust grain here close to the filamentary structure. So it's even more pronounced when we use a high resolution. So now the game is to know, are the dust evolving already at the molecular cloud stage? So I think there is a lot of things to do here. I will now conclude. I hope I have illustrated that star formation in the ISM requires very specific tools that have to be multi-scale and multi-physics. So we need a lot of physics coming from both the large scale and the very small scales and even microphysics in order to describe the star formation process. We have seen that magnetic field and radiative transfer and stellar feedback have really some effect and that we can measure at all scales, and I've illustrated that clearly numerical simulation are a good way to help to better understand fundamental problems like the star formation rate, the angular momentum, and the magnetic flux issues. So there are a lot of things, I think, to be done. As I already mentioned, connect the scales, so influence of the galactic scales on the smaller scale and also the contrary, and explore more initial conditions, so to match maybe extragalactic, sorry, galaxy, and also to look at the evolution of dust throughout the scale, so from the galactic disk, where maybe dust are produced down to the protoplanetary disk. And I will finish.
Okay, thanks, Benoit. We have time for questions. Okay, we will go back in time. Let's start with question on the last part. Why is there a difference of coupling between small and large grains? Difference of inertia?
Exactly. So the larger the grain, the longer the time it needs to adapt to the smallest drag, in fact. Okay. So you see, it is directly proportional to the size of the grain, the stopping time. Okay. The grain intrinsic density. So it depends also on how fluffy maybe the grain is.
How does radiative feedback lead to a top heavy IMF given that you have to lose energy to collapse? I understand that there is pressure support due to radiative feedback, but that energy must be lost to form stars anyway. So how is the IMF affected by the radiative feedback?
Well, it's just that you form stars, so the first stars, and this one will accrete the material because they prevent any further fragmentation, but you still have a region where you do not form massive stars that do not radiate a lot. So you have still some space to form both the high mass stars and the less massive stars, but the high mass star radiates much more than the low mass one, and then they get after all the mass. So you form less star than without the relative feedback, but you still form a significant number. Okay, so you still form enough to have the IMF.
Okay, does the molecular cloud survive the formation of a stellar cluster?
Well, I think in what I've shown, so it depends. Numerical experiment can show that if you consider, for instance, supernova explosion, it depends very much on where does the supernova explode. Okay, if it is in the center of the cloud, then it's hard for the supernova to propagate within the cloud. Okay, because it's highly concentrated. But if it explode at the border also of the cloud, then it will have a different effect. The same for the formation of the most massive stars. It also depends on how much massive star will explode or radiate, and there can be a cumulative effect that can also destroy the molecular cloud. So clearly, these are numerical experiments that are running and that can help to calibrate what is the star formation efficiency of a given molecular cloud. Okay, and then we can calibrate a subgreen model for galactic evolution.
Thanks. Okay, 2-in-1. What are the conditions that define when do the first and second collapse of a prestellar core start, and why the velocity of the matter ejected by the second core is much larger than the velocity of the matter ejected by the first core?
Okay, so what is the beginning of the question?
What are the conditions that define when do the first and second collapses of a prestellar core start, and the second one is about velocity, the difference in velocity. Yeah.
So the conditions are, so for the first collapse is when the dense core becomes gravitationally unstable and that the medium is not optically thick, okay? So the collapse can proceed through the dust thermal emission, okay? And then the second collapse occurs because of H2 dissociation, okay? So you need to take some energy to break the H2 molecule, so it's 48 electron volt per molecule of H2. So once you dissociate H2, then you cool down the gas and you get an effective gamma, which is less than 4/3. And then you see that the mass, Jeans mass, will decrease with the density. Okay, meaning that we are again gravitationally unstable. For the ejection velocity, so what we think is that the outflows are launched by magnetic processes, and in particular by the magnetocentrifugal process. So the magnetocentrifugal process is that the magnetic field line rotates, okay? And if the opening angle of the field line is large enough, then material can be ejected along the magnetic field line, okay? And you see that the efficiency of the ejection will then depend on the amount of rotation. And the faster the rotation, the faster the gas will be ejected. And it is simply that the Keplerian velocity gets larger as you go to smaller and smaller scales. So then when you go to the protostellar core scale, then you get much larger rotation velocity and then much larger ejection also velocity.
Mm-hmm. Thanks. Well, maybe we have time for our last one. So this one was written when we were showing the state of the art 10 years ago. Mm-hmm. What are the boundary conditions for these dense core simulations?
Isolated. So this is really the isolated paradigm. But it doesn't change very much, even if we take something which is periodic, because usually the size of the core is 1/4. The radius of the core is 1/4 of the box size, and we are not affected by the boundary condition if we use periodic boundary conditions. So it will maybe change a bit, let's say, the free fall time, so increase by 10%, but it won't change the picture.
Thanks.
But still, we have to be careful with the condition for the magnetic field here at the border, so we need to preserve DFB. And we have a problem, for instance, when we launch outflows and when they reach the computational domain in border, we cannot integrate them further.
Okay, so there are still a few questions left, but as Jérôme just reminded you, Benoît will discuss lively during the coffee break, which will last 30 minutes. Mm-hmm. So the link is on the Slack and also in the chat of the Zoom. So don't hesitate to join Benoît for the coffee break. And thank you again, Benoît, for this very nice lecture.